families, are you ready for another great Sunday full of some awesome worship and learning about God? I know I am, but I think it's game time. Sean, are you up to play?
Oh, you know I am. This week's game is called Read My Lips. Sarah and I will each take turns saying a phrase from something we've learned over the past few weeks, except the sound will be muted.
We have to figure out what the other person is saying just by reading their lips. Feel free to play along at home and figure out what we're saying.
All right, let's see how good I am at this. Here we go. First one. Oh man, this is gonna be rough. Something I'm thankful for you. Something I'm thankful for you. That's all I got. Let's hear what it actually is.
The Lord has a plan for you.
So close. The Lord has a plan for... Oh, of course that's what it is.
How did I know? Okay, the last word is promises. I know that. How did I know to see the promises? That's my final guess. Playing it with the volume on.
Our God always keeps his promises. Okay, here we go. Let's see if this is any better. Okay, I think one of the words in there is Jesus. All of Jesus. Ooh, gosh, this is tough. All of Jesus next to you, Jesus is always with you. Oh my goodness. Okay, let's hear what it actually is.
I love Jesus, yes I do. I love Jesus, how about you?
Yeah, that makes sense now.
I wonder if there'll be hot rods. I wonder if there will be hot rods on Haven. Is there a car show coming up? I wonder if there will be hot rods on Haven. That's my final guess. Turn the volume on.
I wonder if heaven will have narwhals. All right, I've got to get this one. Come on, here we go. Okay, the first word is Jesus. I'm 90% sure on that. Jesus was a pretty good sailor. I think, you know, he's on the boat a few times. Oh man, I think I got this one.
Jesus wore some pretty cool sandals.
So close. Wow, I really gotta work on this lip reading stuff. And I do believe there will be narwhals in heaven. Maybe, hopefully.
I sure hope so. Now I say we all stand up and worship.
Hi friends, I'm so excited to get to worship with you today. We are going to jump into a super fun song. It has some great dance moves, so let's get going. Step out of the grave, break into the wild, and don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces, grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Bring all of your burdens, bring all of your scars. to communion. Come back to the start. Run into wide open spaces. Grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted. Grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Let there be freedom. Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name. There is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. There is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. For the Spirit is here, let there be freedom. Let
Hey Hillsides families, it's Sarah and I'm back for this week's edition of Questions from Kids. Our question this week comes from Jason, who's 10, and he asked, if God is everywhere, why do we go to church? Great thinking, Jason. You're so right, God is everywhere. But there's something really awesome that happens when we gather together to praise God's name. See, the church is not the place that we meet. The church is God's people. And there's something really heartwarming about the fact that we get to come together as a community to celebrate and thank God, not only for what He's doing in our lives individually, but also what He is and will continue to do for our lives as a community. So whether you gather at a church building or outside or even at your home, God calls us to be together and to encourage each other to love one another and care for those around us. So right now, turn to someone next to you and say, God loves you. That's right, God loves you. Take a second today to encourage those around you to keep loving God and to continue to love others. That's all we have today, but don't forget to submit your questions to our Instagram link in our bio, and I'll answer your question next week. I'll see you then. Bye.
When God's people stopped rebuilding God's temple, God sent prophets to give His people a message. Zechariah was one of the prophets who told the people what God said. This was God's message: return to me and I will return to you. God reminded the people about their parents and grandparents and great-grandparents. The prophets told them to stop sinning, but they did not listen. So God had punished the people for their sin. Don't be like them, God said. One night, God gave Zechariah some messages through visions. Zechariah saw 8 visions. Each was a different message from God about something that was going to happen. In the first vision, Zechariah saw a man riding on a red horse. Behind him were other horses. They had been patrolling the earth. Everything was calm and quiet, but soon the Lord would punish his enemies. The Lord's house would be rebuilt, and his cities would be blessed again. In the second vision, Zechariah saw 4 horns. These stood for Israel's enemies. Zechariah also saw 4 craftsmen who would defeat those enemies. Next, Zechariah saw a man going out to measure Jerusalem. But the city could not be measured because it was too big for walls. Instead, the Lord would be a wall of fire around it. In the fifth vision, Zechariah saw a solid gold lampstand, which showed how all the Lord's plans would happen because of his spirit. Then Zechariah saw a flying scroll, which was a curse on everyone who disobeyed God. In the seventh vision, a woman sat inside a basket. She represented the wickedness of those who worship false gods. She was lifted up and taken back to Babylon. In the eighth vision, Zechariah saw 4 chariots, like the horses of the first vision. They would patrol the earth. God told Zechariah to collect silver and gold from the people. Use the gold and silver to make crowns, he said, and place them on the head of Joshua, the high priest. Joshua's crowns meant that a special king was coming to bring peace for everyone. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, humble and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey, Zechariah said. God promised to bless his people and punish the rest of the nations for their sin. One day, everyone will worship the Lord. God was going to help his people and give them a different kind of king. Jesus is the king who came and rode humbly on a donkey, just as Zechariah said. Because Zechariah's prophecy came true in Jesus, we can have hope and forgiveness of sins when we trust in Jesus.
As we look at this story, we have to remember that God's people back then didn't have what we have today. Jesus hadn't come yet, but we have the Holy Bible, and it tells us everything we need to know about Jesus and how he came to be our forever Savior and King. And he fulfilled every prophecy, including riding on a donkey. Have any of you ever tried to ride a donkey? Apparently, it's not easy. So yeah, that would have probably been me as well. But Jesus came riding on a donkey to show the people that he was a humble king of peace. As you saw in the video, God revealed his plan to Zechariah in 8 visions. And some of those visions were about the temple and how God wanted his people to rebuild the temple in Jerusalem. And then many of the other visions were about Jesus, the coming Messiah. Zechariah's visions from God looked to a future kingdom, which was the church, and a future king who was Christ. And that's what we have today. The church is God's kingdom. And I'm not talking about the building, because buildings are temporary. They can get smashed by a tree, demolished, but you know what can't be destroyed? Our spirits and our faith in God. That's forever. So the church are people like you and me and everyone who's a follower of Jesus. Something else that's special about this story is Zechariah's name. It means the Lord remembers. And God's people needed to be encouraged and reminded that God remembers and that He always keeps His promises. God's people saw all the other countries living peacefully, and their city was ruined. They may have felt like God had forgotten them or abandoned them. Have any of you ever felt like that or needed encouragement? I know I have. Sometimes when I'm really sad, God puts my name on someone else's heart. One time, I was so sad. I was on my couch, crying. I was just having one of those days. I couldn't go anywhere, I couldn't see anyone, and everything was just going wrong, and I was sad. And then I got a random text from an old friend, and it said, "Hey Cynthia, I know we haven't spoke in a long time, but I just wanted to let you know that I love you and I'm praying for you." God sent someone to encourage me. He hadn't forgotten me. And He cared so much about what I was going through that He sent someone just for me. God always keeps His promises to His people. When God sent Zechariah the prophet to speak to His people, even Zechariah's name would be an encouragement that God had not forgotten them or His promises. I hope you guys were really encouraged today, and I hope you go into your small groups with a lot of questions. I can't wait to see you guys next week. Bye.